Thanks a lot, Robert. Thanks a lot, David, Jacob, and everybody who took part to the organization of this event. So let me first apologize that, you know, as you can hear, my English sounds a lot like French, and you know, I'm sorry about this, and you know, I hope you will be able to understand what I have to say. I should also, you know, pay tribute to my translator, Arthur Goldhammer, who translated my book, which was originally written into French, into English. And you know, as you can see, I'm not very good with foreign language, and my written English is much less good than my written French. And thanks to Arthur, this book, I think, reads beautiful in the English language, or at least it reads much better than what I would have been able to do by myself. And in particular, in order to be able to talk about the literature, and I'm very happy, Robert, that you made reference to Balzac, you know, this is something I'm able to do in French much better than in English. So in this presentation, I will try to give you a sense of some of the material that's included in my book, Capital in the 21st Century. Probably I will not refer as much to the literary materials than I would like to, but given that, Robert, you made reference to Balzac, you know, I would like to say that a big part of my motivation for looking at these issues of inequality and for collecting the historical data that is at the core of this book, a substantial part of my motivation actually came from the literature. And I think the literature has a unique, powerful way to express the consequences of inequality and the consequences of money in the life of people. And the language of social science and economic research is not as beautiful, but I think it can also be useful to answer some of these same questions. And in particular, one of the key questions I wanted to answer is the relative importance of work and wealth and inherited wealth over the course of development. And I was always very impressed by this, you know, this very strong reality of money and inheritance in the 19th century novels, not only in Balzac, but in Jane Austen and in many other countries' literature. And you know, I thought, is it just that they were obsessed with money? And of course, Balzac, as you know, was writing novels all the time to repay its own debt, because he had been very, he was not very successful as a businessman. He tried a number of businesses and ended up with so much debt that he had to write all these novels to repay his debt. So was this the only reason why there is so much about money and inheritance in Balzac? Well, no, I think it's much more than this. It's because the flow of inherited wealth at that time, as compared to the flow of labor income, were indeed very large, not only in the literature, but also in the actual world, in the statistics. And for a long time, I was trying to answer, okay, what determines in different societies and across the course of history the relative importance of transmission of wealth over labor income? What part of our institutional system, our legal system, our policies, our history determines the relative importance of the two over time? And I have made a little bit of progress in my understanding of this issue. And this is what I would like to share with you today. But you know, I should make clear that this work comes from a very collective research project. I started collecting historical data on income and wealth in France about 15 years ago, and then I was very fortunate to find with Tony Atkinson collecting data for the case of Britain. With Emmanuel Saez, we've been working on the case of the US, and Emmanuel has worked also on Japan and Canada. With Facundo Alvaredo, we've been working on Argentina, on Spain, with Abhijit Banerjee on India, with Gilles Postel-Vinet, Jean-Laurent Rosenthal, Gabriel Zucman, we've been working on the history of wealth rather than income. I cannot list everybody, but this is really a collective research program, and this is an ongoing research program. So in the book, I use, you know, this is really a photography of the historical data that we have at one point in time, but we still have too little data, of course, to be sure about anything. This is the beauty of the social sciences. We start from very low, and we can make a little progress, but you know, it's not that we can be sure about any interpretation, and we will keep collecting data in order to try to test more of the mechanism. So in this presentation, I'm going to present a couple of results, mostly taken from part 2 and 3 in the book. if you want to have a better sense of the material that is covered in the book, you can look at this website. I'm sorry that I cannot put the book online. My publisher will disagree, but at least at least you will find the all the data, all the statistical series online. So in this presentation, I'm going to make three points, basically. So I'm going to start with the first point about income inequality, and then I will go to wealth inequality, well, wealth income ratio and wealth inequality. So the first point will be about the long run dynamics of income inequality. And the main conclusion will be that the idea of the end of the Kuznets curve, the end of universal laws, and the fact that country specific institutions and policy matter a lot if you want to understand the long run dynamics of income inequality. Then I will turn to what I call the return of a patrimonial or wealth-based society, particularly in Europe and Japan, where wealth-to-income ratio seem to be returning to very high levels, in particularly in countries with low population growth. And a big difference between Europe and Japan on the one hand and the United States is that population growth is much lower in Europe and Japan, and indeed negative in Japan and in some European countries. But to the extent that there will be a growth slowdown at some point in the future everywhere, particularly population growth, this might be relevant for the entire world. And I will also emphasize the fact that the metamorphosis of capital, by which I mean the transformation of the different forms of capital assets over time, raises new challenges about the regulation of property relation. And my third point will be about the future of wealth inequality, wealth concentration, and I will argue that one of the important determinants is the gap between R and G, or the net of tax rate of return, particularly on large wealth portfolio, and the growth rate G. And to the extent that this gap will be higher in coming decades than it was in the post-war period, this can be a powerful force leading to higher wealth inequalities than what we have now. Now, of course, other forces can play a role, in particular policy responses and institutional changes can change this. And generally speaking, I will stress the need for more transparency so that we can adapt our institution and policy to whatever happened. So let me start with the first point, the long-run dynamics of income inequality. So a big part of the income data that I present in my book comes from this world top income database, where so all countries in red are in the database, the countries in blue are about to enter the database. And I should say that one positive impact of the publication of my book is that we have now more governments that let us use the fiscal data that they used to. So in particular, there are some countries that are not in blue on this graph, like Mexico or Korea or Taiwan, for which we now have better access to fiscal data, and we are trying to extend this work permanently. And so, you know, some of the countries that are not covered in my book, you know, it's not that I am not interested in them, it's just that access to the historical data was not possible until recently. So what does it mean to be in the database? Well, what this means is that we try to use all the historical data on income that we could find for a given country. And usually, the oldest source of information of income comes from the income tax itself. Okay, so it's important to have in mind that taxation is more than just taxation. It's also a way to produce information. It's a way to produce legal categories, statistical categories, so that society can better know itself and better know the evolution of important dimensions over time. So the modern income tax was created in 1913 in the United States, in this country. It was created in the summer of 1914 in France, which was one of the last developed countries to create the income tax. In Britain, the income tax that already existed in the 19th century was transformed into a progressive income tax in 1908, 1909. In Germany, Japan, and a number of Nordic European countries, it was created a bit before that, around 1880, 1890. In some other countries, it was closer to 1920. So generally, it is between 1900 and 1920 that we have the modern income tax and that we can start using historical data on income. So of course, the income tax data is not perfect, but it's better than no data at all. And in the 19th century, when there was no income tax, there's very little systematic information on income. So like in France, when there was no income tax, you had the contribution des portes et fenêtres, the contribution on the doors and windows. So you have all sorts of fascinating statistics on the number of doors and windows by department, which you know, is very interesting, but you have no information on income. So taxation is important, again, because it creates these legal categories and this ability to register economic transaction and to observe economic transaction. And it is true for income. It is also true for wealth. So now we are able to go back to study wealth, go back to the 18th century or early 19th century, because the taxation of wealth, and in particular the taxation of wealth transmission across generation, is much older than the taxation of income. Because, of course, the taxation of wealth transmission has to do with the registration system for property rights, and this is a very important matter, just to organize society and to organize the proper working of transaction in general. So, in particular in France, you have a pretty modern and universal inheritance tax that is introduced by the French Revolution, and this is why we can go back to the late 18th century and early 19th century when we look at wealth. Now, for income, we have to start around 1900, 1910, but this is already something. So let me show you some examples of what we find from this data. I'm going to present in this presentation three important facts about inequality in the long run, one about income inequality, one about wealth inequality, and another one about wealth-income ratio. These three facts are presented in a very concise manner in a paper, in an article that we published in Science with Emmanuel Saez in 2014. So this is very short. So if you don't want to read the entire book, you know, I recommend, you know, that's a good thing with real science, is that they want really concise and short papers. So this is like a 5-page paper. So initially, I thought this was very painful to write a 5-page paper, but in the end, I think it's a good paper. Well, again, there's more in the book. You should read the book, but if you don't want to read the book, you read these 5 pages, where in particular we present these three basic facts. So, fact number one. In 1900, 1910, income inequality was substantially higher in Europe than in the US. In 2000, 2010, it is the opposite. And this basic reversal of inequality between Europe and the US is very interesting in itself, because this shows that the way I will interpret this is that institutions and policies matter. You know, it's not that you have some countries that are always more unequal than others. It depends on the choice we make to organize ourselves. There are different ways to organize capitalism, and there are different institution policies that can make a difference. So let me show you a simple graph illustrating this. So this is the share of total income going to the top 10% of the distribution. So you can see how the US has become substantially more unequal than Europe in recent decades, whereas a century ago it was the opposite. So there was a general decline in inequality between 1910 and 1950, both in Europe and in the US, which is what Kuznets found for the first time in 1950. So Kuznets was an American economist, well, Ukrainian-born, but American economist, who first computed the first national accounts for the US in the interwar period, so the first GDP series. And he was also the first one in the 1950s to use the income tax data for the US to compute the evolution of the share of total income going to the top 10%. And he came with a very good news, which was a decline in income inequality between 1910 and 1950, which a number of observers in the post-war period interpreted as a general law, the view that in advanced stages of development, you have a decline in inequality, and then a stabilization at lower inequality level. And all what we've done, in a way, is to extend the work of Kuznets to many more years and many more countries. But you see that the fact that we now have more years changes completely the perspective, because in particular, you have this big increase in inequality in the US in recent decades, which you know, completely transforms the sort of very optimistic Kuznets curve theory that people had in the 1950s. So in Europe, you also have an increase in inequality, but it's much less substantial. So what do I mean by Europe, by the way, because Europe is a complicated continent. So this is the GDP-weighted average of Germany, France, Britain, Italy, and Sweden. So it's not quite Europe, but it's a big part of Western Europe, and most continental European countries have a fairly close evolution. So, you know, for simplicity, let's call it Europe. And you can see that you have a substantial difference between the two. Now, before we come to the explanation, let me mention that on this graph, in order to focus on long-run evolution, I show you decennial averages, so everything looks very smooth. When you look at annual series, so I'm going to show you the equivalent annual series for the US, you can see that it is much less smooth. You know, you have a lot of short-run fluctuation, in particular when you include capital gains. So with capital gains, you know, you have this very big variation. Look at the end of the period. You know, you can see that 2008, 2009 are not a very good time to exercise your capital gains or to cash your stock options or to get a high bonus as a top manager. But then in 2012, which is the latest data point on this graph, you are above 2007, which was itself above 1928. In 2013, from the preliminary data we have, it declined a little bit. But you know, when you look at the long run picture, you know, when you take decennial averages, which is what I take for the US compared to Europe, you know, the difference is absolutely clear. And so, you know, I prefer to focus on the long run evolution. But the short run story is also interesting. Okay? It's also interesting to put on the same graph. So this is Europe, the US. You can also put Japan on this graph. So that's interesting because so Japan is like the third part of the rich world, if you want. And so you can see Japan is in between Europe and the US in terms of rising inequality. So that's interesting because you have three different trajectories. So this means that the explanation, you know, if you want to explain this, you have to come with explanations that are country specific, or at least that do not apply exactly the same way to Europe, Japan, and the US. And in particular, the usual explanation that people give for rising inequality, which is basically globalization, is not quite enough because globalization happened not only in the US, but also in Japan and in Europe. So I'm not saying, you know, so the usual explanation will be, okay, you have China entering the world labor market, lots of low-skilled workers who enter the world labor market. This is pushing the wages and employment opportunities of low-skilled and medium-skilled groups in rich countries downwards, and this is the explanation for rising inequality. And now I'm not saying this is not important at all. I'm just saying that this cannot be the only explanation, otherwise you would have the same rising inequality pretty much everywhere in Europe, Japan, and the US. So, you know, usually also with this explanation, you have a pretty sort of conservative conclusion is that, you know, we cannot do anything about it because globalization is good for other reasons, so, you know, there's not much you can do. Now, what this evidence shows is that, you know, there are different ways to organize globalization and capitalism. So let me list a little bit what are the factors that can make a difference. First, the rise in US inequality in recent decades has been mostly rising inequality of labor income. Although at the end of the period, rising inequality of capital income and property is starting to become very significant and it started to feed into the process and recent research by Saez and Zucman shows that this in the future can become more and more important. But for the most part, this rising inequality over this period is due to rising inequality of labor income. So this is due to a mixture of reasons, changing supply and demand for skills, race between education and technology. Globalization is certainly important, but you need more than that. You need a country-specific explanation. So maybe in the US, you have more unequal access to skills as compared to Europe and Japan. Could be because of rising tuition fees and insufficient public investment in education. Also, in the US, you have unprecedented rise in top managerial compensation, much bigger than in Europe and Japan, which can be accounted for by a mixture of reasons, changing corporate governance, changing social norms, changing incentives. Maybe, in particular, the very large cuts in top income tax rates that have happened in the US since the 70s, which used to be, you know, the US used to be the country in the world with the highest top tax rate, and suddenly became, after Reagan, the rich country with the lowest top income tax rate, probably has changed dramatically the incentives for top managers to try to get very large pay increase sometime at a scale that is really difficult to reconcile with performance or any observable productivity or performance outcome, and which maybe in some cases has more to do with the ability to put the right people in the right compensation committee, and the decline in very top income tax rate has probably changed, contributed to change dramatically the incentives to do that. Labor market institution, and in particular falling minimum wage in the US, certainly played an important role. So, you know, whatever you believe about the exact weight of these different explanations, it is clear that there's an entire mixture of institution and policy, from education policy to corporate governance, taxation, labor market policy, which can contribute to different outcomes. So just to emphasize this a little bit more, let me show you two examples. So if you compare, so this is the real value of the minimum wage in France and the US since 1950, expressed in dollars of 2013 or euros of 2013. So you can see that the minimum wage used to be a lot higher in the US, and it's now a lot higher in France. Now, some people in France maybe will say that the minimum wage is too high in France, and I'm not going to take a stance on this, but certainly I think it is too low in the US, or at least you can see, you know, the real value, the minimum wage right now at the federal level in the US is a little bit more than $7 per hour. It used to be more than $10 per hour in the late 1960s, in dollars of 2013. So in other words, you have a significant decline in the real purchasing power value of the federal minimum wage in the US over a 50-year period, which is quite unusual in a country to have a decline in the real value of the minimum wage over a 50, you know, half a century. And the unemployment rate was not higher 50 years ago than today. So you know, it's not that the minimum wage was amazing, it was far too high and created a lot of unemployment. It was the same as today, the unemployment rate. And the minimum wage was higher. And certainly this contributed, the decline in the minimum wage contributed in rising wage inequality. Just to mention another example, this is a graph which I take from recent work by Emmanuel Saez and Raj Chetty, which I find particularly striking. This is the parent income rank in the distribution, so you can be in the bottom 10% or bottom 20% of the distribution, or in the top 10%. And this is the percentage of each cohort attending college, and this also, you know, this could go from 0 to 100. And you can see that what you get is almost the first diagonal. You know, it's as if you go from 0% when your parents are poor to 100% when your parents are rich. Well, not quite, you know, you start with a 20% chance of accessing college, although typically this is not the same college than when you are up there, okay? But, you know, at least you start with 20% and you go to 90, 95% when your parents are at the top. This is the situation right now in this country, and this I find quite striking because it means that you have a theoretical discourse about meritocracy and equal opportunity, and then you have the reality, which is a bit different. And you know, the gap is quite striking. So I think, you know, in every country, you have a lot of hypocrisy about meritocracy, and certainly in my country, in France, you know, there is a lot of hypocrisy where we, you know, we claim we are strongly attached to equal opportunity, and then we put three times more public resources in the most elitist schools than in the most disadvantaged institutions. So, you know, I'm not going to say that any country, you know, it's a problem in every country. No country is able to solve this problem in a satisfactory manner. But it's possible, there is evidence suggesting that in the US it's even more extreme, and that unequal access to higher education in this country has taken proportions which are more extreme than in Europe and in Japan, generally speaking. There is some evidence, which I quote in my book, showing, for instance, that the average income of the parents of Harvard undergrad students, and I don't know the number for Yale, but corresponds to the average income of the top 2% of the US distribution of family income. So, of course, you have some students who come from below the top 2 because you have financial aid, etc. But what this means is that these students who come from below the top 2 are sufficiently few and the students who come from the top two come from sufficiently high within the top two, then the overall average is as if everybody had been picked at random within the top two. Which is a situation which, again, I find quite striking. If you do similar computation for elitist places like Sciences Po in Paris, you get the top 9% instead of the top two, which is still very unequal, but at least it's four or five times bigger. So I think, you know, this is a domain where the gap between the theoretical discourse in favor of mobility, meritocracy, and the reality of what we do through our policies and institutions and admission procedure is really quite striking. Okay, so let me now move to my second point. So now I'm going to move from the discussion of income inequality to the discussion of wealth, which I think in the long run is even more important. So of course, wealth partly comes from the accumulation out of income, so higher income inequality tends to lead to higher wealth inequality later on down the road. But wealth inequality is more than just the continuation of income, and it involves other specific processes. So I'm going to make two points. I'm going to start with point two. So point two is going to be about the return of a patrimonial or wealth-based society in the old world, and particularly in Europe and Japan, where wealth-to-income ratio seem to be returning to very high levels. That's particularly true in countries with low population growth. And the basic intuition is that in a slow-growth society, wealth accumulated in the past can naturally become very important. And in the very long run, this can be relevant for the entire world to the extent that you have population growth slowed down pretty much everywhere, and maybe also productivity growth slowed down as emerging countries catch up with the richest countries. Now, this is not bad in itself, but this raises few new challenges. And generally speaking, I will emphasize the transformation in the form of ownership and the fact that the metamorphosis of capital assets call for new regulations of property relations. And then I will move to my third point, which is more about the inequality and the concentration of property, whereas my second point is more about the total value of assets and capital. Okay? So I started with fact number one, which was that there was a reversal on income inequality between the US and Europe. Fact number two is that you also have a reversal for wealth inequality, and that wealth inequality is always higher than income inequality. Fact number three is that wealth inequality today is still less extreme than a century ago in Europe. Although the total capitalization of private wealth relative to national income has now recovered from the World War shocks in Europe and also in Japan. So that's why it's important to distinguish the total capitalization of wealth on the one hand and the inequality of wealth on the other hand. The fact that you have very high total capitalization of wealth is not necessarily bad in itself. If you have a large part of wealth that is owned by a large and prosperous middle class, then having a very large capitalization of wealth is not necessarily a bad thing. So the question is how concentrated is wealth, and it's important to distinguish these two dimensions. So let me show you the similar graph for wealth inequality. So you can see, so this is exactly the same graph as what we had before for income inequality, but you can see first that the level of inequality are higher for wealth. You know, remember for income, the US went from top 10% income share of about one third in the 70s to about one half today. And these are the typical orders of magnitude for income inequality. It goes from one third, or sometimes a bit less than one third, like in Scandinavia, to one half, or a little bit more than one half, like in Brazil, for share of total income going to the top 10%. Now, for wealth inequality, it's always more than one half for the top 10%. And it can be up to, you know, in 1910, at the eve of World War I, it was of the order of 90% in every European country belonging to the top 10%. So this is true in Britain, but also in Sweden, in France, in Germany. And that's quite interesting because at that time, in 1910, 1913, in my country, in France, there was a strong denial of inequality. The view was, well, okay, we have made the French Revolution. So that's enough, basically. You know. And so in particular, that's one of the key arguments that was given by the French Republican elite from the center-right or center-left. against the creation of a progressive income tax. And this is why, largely why France was the last country to create a progressive income tax. And the argument was, well, you know, progressive taxation, that's useful for countries, aristocratic countries like Britain, but for us, you know, we don't need it because we are a country of small property owners, because with the French Revolution, we are now equal under the right of property. Everybody has the same right of property. You don't have aristocrats anymore. So, you know, we are a country of equals. Why would you need progressive taxation? Except that in my archives, in inheritance, what I see is that the concentration of wealth in 1913 in France was just as extreme as in Britain, for one good reason, which is that at that time, as we're going to see in a minute, land did not matter anymore. What mattered in the national capital stock was real estate, business assets, foreign investment, financial assets, much more modern assets. And the fact of being in a republic rather than a monarchy, you know, I'm very happy to be in a republic, but you know, I don't think this makes much of a difference in terms of concentration of wealth. Other institutions than the property right regime and the absence of an aristocracy are important. So, today, the level of wealth concentration, although it has increased in the US and in Europe, you know, is still much less extreme than a century ago. Basically, what you should have in mind is that whatever does not belong to the top 10% belongs to what I call in the book the patrimonial middle class, which are the middle 40%, which are between the top 10 and the bottom 50. So the bottom 50%, basically, they never own anything. Okay, so the share of total wealth owned by the bottom 50% is always less than 5%, you know, maybe 2% in the US, 4% in France, but you know, it's very small. So whatever does not belong to the top 10 belongs to the middle 40. So when you have an increase in the share of the top 10 from 60 to 70%, it means that the share going to the middle class has declined from, you know, 30, 35% to 20, 25% in the US over the past 30 years. You still have a much bigger middle class in terms of share in national wealth than in Europe a century ago, but this is clearly not going in the right direction. Now, before we try to understand why, it's important to realize that although wealth inequality is substantially less than a century ago in Europe, the total capitalization of wealth, so this is what I call the wealth to income ratio, the ratio between the total market value of wealth relative to national income, is now back in Europe to levels which are not too far from the pre-World War I level. In the US, the decline following World War I and World War II was less strong than in Europe, and the increase in recent decades was also less strong. So this is the slow growth effect, the fact that you have less population growth in Europe can explain to a large extent why you tend to accumulate more wealth relative to income. So you have this for the European average. You also have this, you know, if you take Germany, France, United Kingdom separately, you have differences in levels, like the total market value of wealth in Germany is always a bit less than France and the UK, and I will return to this later. That's interesting in itself, but the general evolution is the same in Germany, France, and the UK. So, you know, according to some economic textbook, this is supposed to be a constant. So, you know, as you can see, you know, be careful with economic textbook, because sometimes in economic textbook, when we don't know much about something, we just assume it's a constant. And, you know, of course, if you have only one data point, everything is a constant. But in fact, there's no reason why it should be a constant. You know, in fact, there's no economic model which tells you that the ratio of capital to output or wealth to income should be a constant. Even in the simplest economic model, where you have a one good model of capital accumulation and substitution between capital and labor, any ratio of capital to output can be a constant. It really depends on how much you save and invest as compared to how fast you grow, and the underlying structural growth rate depends on population growth, productivity growth, and depending on the relative importance of these two sets of parameters, you can have any ratio. Now, if you move to more complicated model where you have different forms of assets, different forms of properties, then you have even more possible, different possible outcomes, which is really what we have in the real world. And this is what I want to emphasize, is that in the real world, we have different types of capital assets, and in itself, there's nothing bad with having high wealth-to-income ratio. You know, a lot of this is due to a post-war reconstruction and to the growth slowdown. But this high wealth-to-income ratio creates new policy challenges, particularly for Europe and Japan, but you know, possibly one day for the US as well, and to some extent already for the US, which have to do with financial regulation, real estate bubbles, the return of inheritance. And probably my most important conclusion in this lecture and in my book is that we need to develop a multi-dimensional approach to the history of capital and property relations, because land, business assets, foreign assets, real estate, public debt, immaterial capital, all these different forms of ownership raise different issues in terms of regulation, in terms of legal system, in terms of policy. And when you do the big addition and you just look at the total value of wealth, you know, this can be useful for some purposes, but that's never enough. If you really want to understand what's going on, you need to open the black box and look separately at these different forms of assets and property relations. So let me take a few examples to illustrate this. First, if you take the very long-run evolution of wealth-to-income ratio, and let's take the case of the United Kingdom, which is probably the best documented case. So you can see that at the end of the period, we almost recover from the World War shocks, and the total value of national wealth in Britain relative to national income is close to what we had in the 19th or 18th century, but with a completely different structure. Okay, you see that agricultural land used to be very important in the 18th century, but already in 1910 does not matter anymore. Okay, so landed estates in 1910 are not important anymore. They are important in Dunton Abbey, but this is just for the sake of the fiction. In the real world of the times, this was completely negligible. What is much more important today is first housing, and then other domestic capital. So other domestic capital, this is the capital equipment used by businesses, basically. And here, this is valued at the market value of companies. So this also includes immaterial capital to the extent that the market valuation of companies include R&D investment and the value of patents, etc. And you can see that today, basically half of wealth is housing, with very high increase in housing values in recent decades. And half of it is other domestic capital, so business assets, as they are valued on financial markets. You can see the importance of net foreign capital at the eve of World War I, which was almost 2 years of national income in Britain. So this means that a big part of what people own in Britain was, in fact, located in the rest of the world. So Britain owned a big part of the rest of the world, and this was a very significant part of their ownership. You have the same in France, but with a smaller, you know, the net foreign capital. You know, there are two differences between France and Britain. It takes more time for the agricultural sector to disappear. And also, the net foreign capital is around 1 year of national income at the eve of World War I versus 2 years for Britain. But in both cases, this is very substantial. This means that France and Britain at that time were getting a very large capital income inflow from the rest of the world. So, you know, with a rate of return of 4-5%, you know, when you have 1 or 2 years of national income in foreign assets in the rest of the world, it means that they were getting 5-10% of extra GDP from the rest of the world in rent, interest, profits. And so this is why, you know, France and Britain between 1870 and 1914, they had a permanent trade deficit, 2-3% of GDP, but this was not a problem because the income inflow from the rest of the world in rent, interest, dividend was enough not only to pay for the deficit, but to keep paying the rest of the planet, okay? So this is, you know, it's as if you're paying rent to your owner, and with the money, your owner is paying the rest of the building, okay? So this is a bit, you know, property relations are always complicated. It's always complicated to pay rent to your owner, but when it's a country paying rent to another country, according to economic textbooks, this is supposed to be smooth and harmonious, but in the real world, of course, this came with political domination, and this is complicated. Well, anyway, this ended with World War I and World War II and decolonization, where rich British and French households had to sell many of their foreign assets in order to buy public debt to pay for the war. And the war itself was in effect destroying some of the rest of the capital stock. And at the end of the process, the public debt itself was inflated away after World War I and World War II. So there was not much left. And you know, this is a sad story, but this is the story of Europe. And this is what you have on this graph. So you can see that to understand all these different dimensions, you really need to look separately at these different form of assets. In particular, in the recent period, increase in housing values have been a very important part of the increase in wealth to income ratio. And this can create a number of difficulties. So you can see here, I am showing you the same wealth to income ratio for more countries. And I am showing you the annual series instead of the decennial averages, so that you can see that it's a lot more chaotic. You can see the Japanese housing bubble around 1990. If I show you now the Spanish bubble, which you have over there, you know, it's even bigger than the Japanese bubble. Okay, so in other words, you know, wealth to income ratio, having high wealth to income ratio are not necessarily bad in themselves, except that sometimes they come with asset price bubble. It's always difficult to put a price on capital, whether it's real estate or the stock market. And you tend to have sometimes excessive valuations and financial panic. And of course, making a mistake on the price of your capital assets when the ratio of private capital to GDP is 6 or 7 years, this has tremendous consequences than much more than when the ratio of wealth to income is 2 or 3 years of GDP, like what it was in 1970. So this is a new policy challenge in the sense that if you make a 10% mistake on the price of your real estate in Spain, you know, the consequences for the real economy can be extremely damaging. This also has consequences for the return of inheritance. When you have very high real estate value and very high capitalization of private wealth at the end of the period in Spain, in Italy, in France, in Britain, you know, it means that for the new generation, accessing property is difficult. If you don't have family wealth and you only have your labor income, this will have to be a pretty high labor income. So having high wealth to income ratio is not necessarily bad in itself, but this creates new policy challenges. Another policy challenge I would like to mention is the fact that part of the increase in the private wealth to income ratio has to do with the decline of public wealth to income ratio. So what is public wealth or public capital? Well, this is defined in the same way as private wealth. So this is the difference between assets and liabilities. So look at Italy. At the end of the period, Italy has a negative public capital. So Italy, that's a very interesting example because it's at the bottom of the class for public capital and at the top of the class for private capital. And of course, the two are related because someone has to buy the public debt and has to buy the privatized public assets. Okay? So what it means to have a negative public capital of Italy at the end of the period is that you have more debt than public assets. Okay? So it means that even if the Italian government was to sell all the public assets at the end of the period, all the public schools, public hospital, public building, public financial assets, although they don't have much, but that will not be enough. That will not be enough to repay the public debt. They will still have minus 60-70% of national income in public debt. So I'm not saying that they should do this. And many people will be shocked if we had to pay rent to the owners of the public schools to which we send our children. So I'm not saying they should do this, but on the other hand, in a way, this is already what they are doing, because when you have public debt that is bigger than the value of your public assets, it means that through interest payment on your public debt, you can end up paying more than what you would pay in rent to the owners of the public buildings. And right now, Italy is putting 5-6% of GDP each year in interest payment for their public debt, whereas the total budget of their university system is about 1% of GDP. And is this a good way to prepare the future? This is not entirely clear. So, you know, I'm not saying that public capital should be higher than private capital. We are all happy that we don't live in capitalist, in communist countries where, you know, public capital will be higher than private capital. But, you know, when public capital is zero or negative, I think it's a bit too small, and it limits the ability of the public authorities and the government to invest in the future, invest in education, invest in infrastructure. Let me mention yet another example about the peculiar structure of capital ownership in the United States of America. And generally speaking, you know, let me stress that inequality in America as compared to Europe has a very different structure, more egalitarian in some ways, more inegalitarian in others. This was already true in the 19th century, where Tocqueville, as we all know, in the 19th century was noticing that the value of land per acre was much lower in the US, and in his view, this was part of the more democratic spirit that would exist in America, where everybody can become an owner because there's so much land that the value of land is less. And indeed, US in the 19th century is the land of opportunity in the sense that capital accumulated in the past matters much less than in Europe. Perpetual population growth also acts as a way to reduce the level of inherited wealth and wealth concentration. And at the same time, this is also the place where you have another form of property, which arguably is the most extreme form of property relation through the form of slavery. And so let me illustrate very, very concretely what this means. So this is the total value of capital in Europe, well, at least in Britain. Now, if you compare with the same scale, the US at the same period, you can see that in the value of land, as noticed by Tocqueville, is much less. Okay, so the ratio of wealth, and in particular agricultural land, to national income is much less in the US than in Britain, around 1800. Now, so this means that if you just own land, you cannot be very rich, or at least your control over others and your control over resources as compared to 1 year of new output in your country is less strong than in Britain. But at the same time, if you have the good idea to own the people who are working on the land, then this can sort of compensate. And indeed, if you include the value of the market value of slaves during this time period, then you can see that you are getting to a level that is much closer to Europe, with very strong differences between the South and the North. So in the North, there are very few slaves, but in the South, in the end, the value of slaves in terms of market values is more than compensating the lower value of land. So that in the end, if you own not only land, but also the people who work on the land, the total value of what there is to own is higher, land plus slaves, than the value of land in France and Britain. So this is the contrast between a part of the country where capital plays a much less important role than in Europe, and another part of the country where you have, in a way, the most extreme form of property relations you can possibly think of. Let me mention finally another example which is closer to us today, which is the stakeholder model of capitalism in Germany, where it's very interesting to see, I have shown that to you before, that the market value of wealth is less in Germany than in France or Britain or the US. So very often we refer to lower real estate prices in Germany, and that's part of the story, which probably itself has to do with the different regulation of rent and rent control in Germany, so it's also related to policy. But in fact, the biggest part of the difference has to do with the lower stock market capitalization of corporations in Germany. And one interpretation is the stakeholder capitalism interpretation, which is that shareholders in Germany have to share the power a little more than in other countries with worker representatives, sometimes regional government, so that the market value is less than the book value of corporation. Now, apparently, this does not prevent German companies from producing good cars, which clearly illustrates the fact that market and social values of capital can differ, and that property relations are socially, legally, historically determined, and the fact of having a more democratic decision power over capital assets is certainly not bad in itself for economic efficiency. So it's important to distinguish between the market and social value. Just to illustrate this very quickly, here you have the ratio between the market value and book value of corporations in a number of countries. So in a textbook economic model with a perfectly functioning capital market, full information, the ratio should be 100% all the time, the market and book value should be the same. Now you can see that in Germany, this is systematically below 100%, you know, 60%, 50%, 60%, whereas in the US and UK, it's much closer to 100%, or actually sometimes higher than 100%. And one interpretation for this is this more stakeholder model of capitalism. Let me move finally to my third point, and maybe let me accelerate a little bit because I don't check the time, but I probably have been too long already. So far, I have not really talked about wealth inequality. I have, you know, my second point was about the return of what I call a patrimonial society, but mostly I was talking about the total value of wealth, the decomposition between different forms of assets, but I did not really tell you anything about the inequality of property, top wealth holders as compared to bottom wealth holders. So this is the third point of my presentation, which I would like to come to now. And here the main point will be the following. The future of wealth concentration involves many different forces, and one of the central issues is, will the share of national wealth going to the middle class, will it keep shrinking or will it increase again? I will argue that one of the important determinants of this, certainly not the only one, but one of the important determinants, is the gap between R and G in the future, where R is the net of tax rate of return and G is the growth rate. And I will argue that to the extent that this gap will be higher in the future than what it was in the post-war period, then wealth inequality might reach or even be higher than 19th century level. Now, conversely, suitable institution and policy can allow to keep democratizing wealth, if you want, and to increase the share going to the middle class, which is already what has happened in the long run, but this process seems to have come to an end, but it could start again. Generally speaking, my main conclusion will be that there is a strong need for more transparency about global wealth dynamics and in particular cross-border financial assets in rich countries and even more so in emerging countries, including China, Latin America, Africa, where the lack of transparency about property rights and wealth inequality is becoming extremely problematic. So first, let me remind you what I have already shown you, which is that the share of total wealth going to the top has started to increase again in rich countries in recent decades. What are the reasons for this? Well, part of it is simply the consequence of rising income inequality. So if you have higher income inequality later on down the road, you also have more wealth inequality. But I think there's more than this going on. In particular, the rising gap between the rate of return and the growth rate can play an important role, maybe particularly at the top of the distribution. So what do we know about what's going on at the top of the distribution? Well, unfortunately, we don't know that much, and we have to use, so on this table, which I'm now going to show you, I actually use data from the Forbes rankings of billionaires, which I should say very clearly that this is not particularly reliable data, and you know, I'm a bit ashamed to show this to you, but you know, we live at a time period, it's a bit sad, you know, I would prefer to show you data from the IMF or from the Eurostat or official government publication in the US and elsewhere, but you wouldn't find this data, partly because we don't have the kind of financial transparency and automatic transmission of information about cross-border financial assets that we will need in order to see this. And the official data sources that we have, both in the US and in Europe, typically household wealth survey conducted by the Federal Reserve in the US or the European Central Bank in Europe, are not very good for the top of the distribution, which is a problem because the top of the distribution is 60-70% of the total. So if you don't get it right for 60-70% of the total, you know, it's a big problem. So we have to do with what we have. So here I use rankings of world billionaires that were published by the Forbes magazine starting in 1987. And so usually what people do with this data is they say, okay, you have more and more billionaires every year. But this is not really surprising because with a lot of high world growth, you know, you have to have more and more billionaires every year. There's nothing bad about this. So here, what I do is a bit more sophisticated, which is I take a fixed fraction of the world population every year, and the world population itself is rising, and I look at how the average wealth of this group is rising over time. And what I find is that the average wealth of this group in real terms has been rising at 6 to 7% per year, which is 3 to 4 times faster than average wealth or average income in the world. Now, when I look at this fixed fraction of the population over time, of course, these are not the same people over time. These people are changing. You know, the people at the top of the list in 1987, according to Forbes magazine, are Japanese billionaires, which everybody has forgotten their name. And whereas in 2013, you have Carlos Slim in Mexico, Bill Gates in the US, people from China, India. So there is a lot of renewal, of course. There's a lot of mobility. So you have some people who go down, some people who go up. But now, this in itself is not a reason for the average wealth of this group to rise 3-4 times faster than the world average. Because if we were in an equilibrium in the world distribution of wealth, the fact that some people go down and some people go up, this should more or less compensate each other. And the average wealth at the top should rise more or less at the same speed as average wealth of the world. You know, there's no problem to have very rich people and very poor people, very middle people, as long as the different groups sort of rise together more or less at the same speed. Now, the problem is that here, you know, they don't rise at all at the same speed, and of course, this cannot continue forever. You know, you cannot have the average wealth at the top rising at 6-7% per year forever when the average wealth for the entire world is rising at 1-2% per year, because otherwise, in the long run, this will mean that the share of world wealth going to the top billionaire will go toward 100%, which I think everybody would agree is too much. And, you know, I'm not saying it's going to go to 100%. I'm sure it will stop before that. But where will it stop exactly? Nobody really knows. And that's a serious concern, because we're already starting from a level of wealth concentration that's substantial. So if we don't know how far it can go higher than that's a serious issue for concern. So what are the explanations for this? So the fact that you have new entrepreneurs, and we do have new entrepreneurs in the world, is not really an explanation, because again, you have some people who go down, you have some people who go up. In itself, this should not explain why the top is rising so much faster than the average. Part of the explanation could be that over this time period, you've had very substantial privatization, which created opportunity for new very top wealth holders. So, you know, if you take Carlos Slim in Mexico, you know, he did not invent the cell phone, but he became owner of a big telecommunication networks. If you take Russian oligarchs, you know, they did not invent oil fields or gas fields. You know, they just became owners of big part of public property at very low prices. So a substantial part of the people at the top of the list in the world, you know, this is related to privatization process in one way or another. Maybe privatization was justified for some efficiency reason, but if you don't have other forms of public regulation over property through taxation or through financial regulation, and then this can become a problem. So, to the extent that there's not much left to privatize, this force should stop and should come to an end. But also with more and more public debt, it's a way to, you know, to make public wealth even negative, so this can continue. Now, another mechanism which can play a role is probably related to the fact that financial deregulation has contributed to increase inequality in financial returns. Okay? So according to the textbook economic model, when you have more sophisticated capital markets, it should allow everyone to access the highest possible return on the planet. And everybody should go to your bank with $10,000 or $100,000, and your money will be invested in China the next morning with the highest yield on the planet. But apparently, the real world doesn't work quite like this. And you know, some people get financial assets that are not so good, and some people get for themselves financial assets that deliver very high returns. And so one way to look at this is to look at the return to the large capital endowments of US universities, which can be of interest to you here. So, you know, the only reason I'm showing you this data, you know, it's not to blame Yale for having such a high return, but it's just because at least this university publishes data. So at least I have data about what they do with their portfolio, and I can see why they get the returns they get, whereas the Forbes people don't publish data. So at least the good thing of universities is that we know what they do. So you have 850 universities in this country with capital endowments. Now you can see that they've done pretty well, you know, 8.2% real return. So this is after deduction of inflation, after deduction of all management fees. So 8.2% is quite good, but now you can say 1980-2010 period was particularly good period. So I'm not saying the return will be as high in the next three decades, but what's interesting is that the higher the endowment, the higher the return. Some of it seems to be due to size effect in portfolio management. So if you have an endowment of 30 or over 40 billion dollars like Harvard now, they actually spend less than 0.3% in management cost each year. But 0.3% of 40 billion is more than $100 million. So if you can pay a group of wealth managers $100 million and if this allows you to have a return of 10 rather than 8 or 6, then it's worth paying 0.3%. Now if you have an endowment of $100 million, you're not going to pay $100 million each year in management fees. And if you have $100,000, all you can do is to ask your brother-in-law what to do with your money. and maybe that's not going to work too well. Okay? When we talk about R versus G, I think it's important to stress that not everybody gets the same R. And rate of return, even if the average rate of return is not so far away from the growth rate, the actual rate of return for different groups of people can vary. And this depends on financial regulations, this depends on institution policy. And here, one solution can be to offer better returns for basic saving accounts. And this is something that, in a number of countries, exist to some extent. Let me conclude by saying that, of course, there are many different institutions and policies that are important to regulate inequality. If we think of wealth inequality, and in particular, the best instrument, ideally, would be to have more transparency about who owns what. And the good thing about a progressive tax on wealth is that this is also a way to produce better information about how the different wealth groups are doing so that we can adapt the tax rate. So, if the top groups are growing at 6-7% per year, this gives you a sense of the tax rate on wealth which could stabilize the inequality of wealth, assuming that this is the objective. Now, if in fact the top wealth groups were not rising at 6-7% per year and were rising at only 1-2% per year, like average wealth, then I would be happy to conclude that we don't need very progressive taxation of wealth. So this is why better information is important, so that we can adapt our policies and institutions to whatever we observe. And there was a proposal, I think, which was made by a professor at this university, Robert Shiler, to index the level of income tax progressivity to income inequality. And I think this is a very good idea. And we could do the same for wealth inequality. In a way, this is what I'm suggesting, which is that we should adapt the level of progressivity on reliable information. Now, is this going to happen? Well, the history of taxation is complicated. So, this is a short summary of top income tax rate in four countries. As you can see, this is a political, social, cultural history and not just an economic history. So you have, one century ago, there was no income tax, and many people said that it will never happen, in particular in this country where the constitution made it impossible to happen, and then it happened. And so, things happen, and so in the US in particular, and in the UK, you have very high top tax rate over this time period. Between 1930 and 1980, on average, it's 82% in the US. Apparently this did not destroy American capitalism. Apparently, if anything, productivity growth was higher in the 50s, 60s, 70s than what it has been since the Reagan years. Probably because this very high tax rate, I should say, were applied only to very high incomes, typically above $1 million in annual income. And the evidence is that paying top managers $10 million rather than $1 million is not so useful, or at least I couldn't find the positive performance effect in the data I could use so far. And so you have the same evolution for the taxation of inheritance. So these are the top tax rate on inheritance, and you can see again that in the US and the UK, you've had much more aggressively progressive taxation, you know, very high progressive tax rates than in France and Germany. So it's interesting, in Europe, a big part of the redistribution in the 20th century was done through destruction, through war, through inflation. And I think that's part of the reason why progressive taxation was used less intensively in France and Germany than in the US and the UK. So I tend to prefer progressive taxation, which I think is a more civilized way than inflation or, of course, destruction. You know, it's interesting to see, you know, look at Germany. The only time when you have very high top tax rate in Germany is between 1946 and 1948. And this is the same right there. You know, in 1946 to 1948, you have 90% top tax rate in Germany. So this is when the tax policy of Germany was set by the Americans. Okay. This was the Allied Control Council that was setting the tax policy of Germany, which was in practice the Americans. And when the Germans took their sovereignty back in 1949, they quickly reduced the top tax rate to, you know, 50% in the 50s because they wanted to get away from this crazy American level of 90%, which they thought were completely crazy. And this is the same in Japan. In Japan also, the only time where you have 90% top tax rate is 1946, 1948. Now, what's interesting is that the Americans at the time were not doing this to punish the German or the Japanese, because they were doing the same at home. So this was not at all a punishment. And in the American view of the time, this was, in fact, in a way that was part of the civilization package. You know, you bring democratic institution, and together with this, you bring fiscal institutions that would prevent democracy from becoming a plutocracy. And so, you know, this seemed very exotic maybe to some of you today, but this looks like ancient history, but this is not so old. And this is part of our common history. And what I really want to conclude in this lecture is that, you know, the history of income and wealth inequality is always deeply political, social, cultural. It involves representations of inequality, belief system, national identities. The main conclusion of my work is that, in a way, both Marx and Kuznets were wrong. There are powerful forces which can push in the direction of rising or reducing inequality. And which one dominates really depends on the institution and policies that different societies can choose to adopt. High gap between rate of return and growth rate can push toward high wealth concentration, but there are many other forces that are also important. The ideal solution involves a mixture of progressive taxation, social state, education policy, financial transparency, economic democracy, including in the board of companies. Of course, there are other solutions to redistribute wealth, like in China or Russia, you have very little transparency, you have very little tax progressivity, and the way you regulate inequality is more by putting in jail a couple of oligarchs from time to time, which is another way to solve the problem, and I don't think this is very efficient. Perpetual population growth has been historically one of the important US way to limit the importance of wealth accumulated in the past. And, you know, of course, this can continue for a long time, and that I know that US universities would like to have the rest of the world moving to the US, but, you know, if we all move to the US, then we will have to find another solution after that. So, you know, perpetual population growth is not really a solution for the entire planet unless we start to have more and more children again. Let me just conclude by saying that some people right now in the US feel that the US is sort of trapped in a high inequality situation because of some form of oligarchic captures with very high income groups having a disproportionate influence on the political institution. And I think this is indeed a major threat. Maybe another reason for this high inequality trap is, as compared to Europe, the lack of a real historical experience with high oligarchic inequality, which makes it
very difficult in Europe to accept political discourse that are that will be, you know, stigmatizing the poor and the losers of the system as violently as what we sometimes hear in this country, and maybe the lack of experience with this extreme inequality that Europe associates to the Belle Époque or to the Ancien Régime or to the 19th and 18th century makes it easier in this country to defend sometimes a pretty extreme view of inequality between groups. In any case, you know, what I wanted to show in this book and in this lecture is that looking at this broad set of international experience and historical experience with income, wealth, inequality, taxation can possibly help us to have a more informed democratic discussion about this important issue. So let me stop there, and thanks a lot for your attention.